Hello, everyone, and welcome to the panel today. We are going to be talking about diversity and inclusion, which covers all manner of sins, largely sins committed against people who really don't deserve it because we're all so incredibly cute. I'm Joan Westenberg. I'm the host today. I am a tech journalist, writer, and a proud transgender woman. I'm going to be joined on the panel by a range of folks who have inspired me an awful lot and give me courage every single day, who I appreciate, follow, and absolutely adore. Before we get into that panel, I want to take a moment to acknowledge the elders past, present, and yet to come, and acknowledge that this panel is taking place on Indigenous lands that were invaded, seized, and have never been apologised for. I am in Sydney. I am speaking from the land of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. I'd like everyone to just take a moment and think about what that means. You know, we're doing a panel on diversity and inclusion. We're doing it over Zoom, but even if we're doing it virtually, we are still doing it on land that doesn't belong to us. And I think that's something to remember and to keep in our hearts as we have this conversation. So this is going to be a recorded panel, so you'll be able to check that out afterwards and have a watch if you like. You can download it and then put it onto a CD and then send it to everybody that you know so they can get to meet me, which is like an absolute bonus for all your friends and loved ones, I think. And we're going to be doing a Q&A at the end, so make sure if you have any questions, you pop them in the chat. We will get through to them, we will have a look, and we will try to answer as many as possible. Unless they're questions I personally don't want to answer, because I get to be the boss today. Woo woo! Kicking off, I would love to invite all of you folks on the panel with me to introduce yourselves, but not just introduce yourselves. I want you to say who you are, what you do, and one thing that makes you fucking angry. Because diversity inclusion is not something that's just happy, clappy, rose gold feminism crap. Like, this is stuff that affects people's lives, and we are talking about systematic exclusion today in various ways. So I'd love to hear who you are, and I'd love to hear something that makes you angry. Who wants to kick off?
Sorry, what makes me angry? Mute button on Zoom. Hey everyone, I'm Aubrey Blanche, and I'm an Indigenous and Latina woman who's also queer and disabled. You know, so if we wanna play diversity, check the box, I'm happy to be there.
You win.
Except let's, tragedy Olympics, not a thing. I'm also the director of Equitable Design at CultureAmp, and a venture capital investor and startup advisor. So I don't have a lot of free time, but what makes me angry? I think what makes me angry right now is like the entire United States of America, and like white Americans specifically. And when I say that, I think it's, you know, when I talk about what it looks like to be anti-racist or to evolve, I think that it's okay to have not known something. But when white supremacy is just destroying the world right now in ways that are so blatantly obvious. And I think it's really disheartening and enraging that we can't sort of point out what's in front of us.
Thank you, Aubrey. Thank you for being here.
I can go. Hi everyone, my name is Claudia Barriga-Larriviere. That's more R's than anybody can usually handle. CBL is fine. Claudia's fine, close friends of mine, a lot of whom are in this panel. Call me CB, either or is fine. I am newly appointed Director of Workplace Equity and Belonging at Aero Co. I will start on the 1st of December to make sure that people have equal access and wonderful experiences in workplaces around the world, and I say that with a full heart, and also I'm largely intimidated by the task at hand. What makes me angry? I'm an organizational designer and a communicator by training, and an empathic, anxiety-driven professional by biological makeup. And I think what makes me the angriest is having been part of a lot of big and small organizations and by various points of their inception. The fact that the beneficiaries of broken structural systems are the ones setting the limits for how far we have been able to go so far. And that those limits are the exact outline of their hurt feelings, it makes me angry that we euphemize so many things and that we have to hit our heads on the wall of people not being able to access or talk about vulnerability and shame, standing on shoulders of privilege. That makes me irate every day. I thankfully have a lot of coping mechanisms, but that doesn't mean that there's a huge hole to shovel to get us out of this problem. So that's what makes me angry.
Thank you, Claudia. I appreciate you. Mina, can I ask you to come next?
Yeah, I didn't want to interrupt Claudia. I'm Mina Radhakrishnan. I'm the co-founder of a prop tech startup here in Sydney called Different. Been in product for a long time. I don't sound very Australian because I'm not. Canadian, actually, but lived in the US for a long time. And, you know, I know this one thing that drives me crazy, and this may seem small, it's the lack of respect people give to multicultural names or names from in languages and places they don't understand, right? We've just seen this happen with like the new VP elect in the United States. Like the fact that a political leader can go up and just like make fun of a name like that, people can't get my last name right. You know, it's okay, I get it. It's a long name, might be hard to pronounce, but ask me, take the trouble to just understand how it's there. It's like, if you can say Daenerys Targaryen, you can say my last name. It drives me really crazy.
Absolutely. And oh God, that's so true. And I appreciate you. Thank you for being here. Alan, the good Alan Jones.
The Jedi Alan Jones.
Radhakrishnan. Have I got that right, Mina?
I'll give you some pronunciation lessons after.
Okay, thank you. So I'm the middle-aged white male on the panel today. I'm an angel investor, aspiring VC, who mentors startup founders in accelerator programs around the place. And the thing that really makes me angry is mindless resistance to change. That people waste so much energy and emotion on trying to take things back to what they believe the world used to be like, or trying to resist the change. Because, you know, you can go down to the ocean and you can try and stop the waves coming in, but the tide's going to come in. And I just wish sometimes that more people could align around encouraging change to happen in a constructive and optimistic and full-hearted way.
Thank you, Aaron. I appreciate you. I'm going to go last here. What makes me angry is that my existence and the existence of most of us in this panel is political and cannot be avoided in being political, because who we are sits outside the norm. And so just the basic ways that we live our lives and basic ways that we do our work becomes a political statement. And when I pick up my little stepson from daycare, that's a political statement. When I write a tweet, that's a political statement. When I publish an article, it's a political statement. And all I really want to do is just live. And so I guess I want to start the panel discussion off right there. I want to talk about diversity and inclusion is this, you know, deja vu thing that we keep getting into over and over again. We're going to talk about diversity and inclusion. How do we do more of this? How do we do more of this? And so what I want to ask people right here, right now, is how do we go beyond that and stop our identities from having to be this thing that needs to be negotiated and accepted and fought for? And how do we just make it so that people can show up to work as themselves without it being a victory?
Probably start over. Just start all of capitalism over. Hmm. It would be the shortest way to do it. That's such an awesome question, Joni, because it has so much of it is behavioral, so much of it is structural, and so much of it is political, as you said. And I think one of the things that I've seen change a little bit in my career doing this over the last few years, specifically in Australia, it's different in the US, definitely different in Latin America, is that we're finally joining the conversation of politics and identity and inclusion as one conversation. Traditionally, my experience in politics in Australia is that is something that happens separate and apart in Canberra, in closed rooms somewhere, and not something that we live every day. I think COVID has really just taking the cobwebs out of that and really kind of exposed it for we're living political decisions every day. And also we have very little representation where somebody in Canberra behind closed doors can make a decision and just wipe out the chance of women rejoining the workforce as they choose to because the daycare costs. And those things are big, huge step backs. Like Alan said, going back into an imagined past that was better. because we're not represented and our interests are not best represented in these channels of power. So that's my take on how do we do it? Let's get represented where it counts.
Yeah, I don't know that I have an answer to it necessarily. probably one of the first steps, right, is acknowledging that I don't think any one of us really has all of the answers and that it's kind of a continuous effort. I guess in my experience, I think the thing that has stood out is this feeling of otherness. Like I remember at Google and being a product manager at Google, and I was like 3 minutes late to a like team, to like an all team meeting one day. I walk in and I'm like, open the door. I'm like, shit, everyone else is here. I'm the only woman. And it's so obvious. It's so obvious, right? It stands out in such a way. And I think that that's the thing, right? Is when you have people from underrepresented backgrounds or from minority backgrounds in a place, especially in tech, where that's not, that is the other, where like the primary is like, you know, kind of like a certain type of person, it just stands out so much more, right? So it, to me, a lot of it comes from a place of just like, how do we make otherness not feel like otherness, where it's like, it's the first thing before everything else comes into play. It's like, oh, she's a brown woman versus like, oh, she's a product manager, right? And it's like, it's changing that kind of definition, I think, which is it's a hard thing to do. And it means you just need a lot more other in the room. Mm. That's the biggest place in every way.
I mean, I definitely don't have all the answers. I plus one everything that's been said. But to quote, Tiffany, if you don't know her, she's a Black woman founder in the US. She runs a nonprofit. And after sort of the murder of George Floyd, she said this like really brilliant thing that we should all put on t-shirts and get tattooed, which is like, make the hire, send the wire. Like, I'm fucking sick of people who want to like, and I get paid to answer it, so I will, but it's like, what do you do if there's like a qualified woman of color who's equally qualified with a white man? Just fucking hire the woman of color. Just do it, right? Because you assume that because of like our shitty brain wiring, because of this information bath that we've been sitting in, like they're probably not actually equal. And like on some level, just choose to make the world different. And I know that sounds like that's actually the solution. It's like every single one of us looks at the decisions that we're making in our life and says like, is this decision right here, whether that's like the tech product I'm building or the job offer I'm handing out or the venture check that I'm writing or like the way that I'm communicating with another individual, like, or whether I'm putting my pronouns on my LinkedIn, like, is that thing creating equity or not? And choose to do the thing that creates equity. And if you don't know what that answer is, then the answer is go learn something. Like Google it, follow Joan on Twitter. I know it sounds so basic, but like, I think that's it, is on some level, we're not asking everyone to solve everything, but like you do stuff all day that can be better and just like do better. And definitely pay women of color more. Like whatever you're paying them, add a 20% surcharge for bullshit.
Yeah, taking that one too.
And disabled people and, you know, trans folks and non-binary folks and literally anyone who's structurally oppressed, like just give us hazard pay for existing.
And on top of that, give trans people chocolate because we deserve chocolate.
Yeah, all something soothing for sure. That's an interesting point you bring up, Aubrey, you and I have spoke about it. I've spoken about this a lot, and I wonder what everybody thinks about this one. The idea, like I've been in so many rooms, like largely a lot of my role over the last 5, 6, 7 years has been around like, how do we pay people and like startups can afford to pay all of these things and blah, blah, blah. And it's how much we can get away with paying, you know, people coming into your organization. And that is one of the things that makes me crazy. But the answer seems to always default to, well, yeah, we need to fix the ladies and the minorities and they need to learn to negotiate better as opposed to just making a statement and structurally saying, well, this is how much we're going to pay for this role and doing that work beforehand as opposed to making it about individual decisions for hiring managers who are largely unequipped to make decisions like that, right? So I don't know if anybody else on the panel has experienced that or has any kind of tips for people listening of how to get over or tackle a problem like that, which is so pervasive. Alan, who's the boss of everybody, maybe.
I just want to hop back to Aubrey and say, like, I'm 100% in favor of quotas, you know, and just always choosing the diverse candidate if I can. And that doesn't have to be the way that all of the world operates forever and ever from now on, just because we choose to do it within an organization or within a community or within an industry for a period of time. You know, it's just it's a thing we do for, and you know, it's a solution, it's a hack, it's a mm-hmm. thing we do for a period of time until things are more equitable. And it's not the only part of the solution, but it can work.
Maybe it's not even a hack. Maybe it's a consequence. You know, it's like when you have a child who is misbehaving, you can say, hey, if you keep on doing this, then there's going to have to be some limits on what you can and can't do. So we've got a whole industry that has just been like, okay, we're going to get better, we're going to get better, we're going to get better, and they keep on not getting better. Well, then they're going to need some quotas because they're obviously just not going to do it on their own. And so quotas are a consequence for them just not getting their shit together. You know, it's like if you keep on running around the place and breaking stuff, sooner or later, you're going to get your toys taken away from you. It's...
Yeah, and accountability is so important in this conversation, for sure.
Well, and I think the thing, I saw someone in the chat say, like, this idea of meritocracy, and I think the thing that's, like, really important to say out loud is, like, the continuing homogeneity of tech is literally mathematically equivalent to mediocrity. And so I think there's something there that's really important to call out, is it, like, the base, like, people like, oh, we don't want to lower the bar. I'm like, it's in the second basement. So like, where are you concerned about it going? And I don't mean that just in terms of representation, because I don't want to be like all white men are evil. I do want to just really quickly say that when I met Alan many years ago, he literally walked into the room and handed me chocolate and like apologized for white men in tech. And so like, you can do that. But like, it's an actual thing that happened. But I think that's a thing that we have to understand, is like, we have to actually think about what excellence looks like. And it looks like having different perspectives in the room. And so if you like assume that underrepresented people by virtue of their existence have something special and unique to offer, it doesn't actually become that hard to do this. But I think we need to be like, to own and to name the idea that like, it's not just about representation, but so often, I mean, I've dealt with like sociopathic executives in my career that were allowed to quit to spend time with family, right? So I think that's the other piece of it. It's not just about representation, but about the people who are in power, like especially lawyers, I'm sorry, but like, I'm looking at you, Google. Like you protect abusive sociopaths because you think that's the thing to do because it puts some money in your pocket. And like, that's just not okay as a human. And I think we all need to start like having social consequences for people who harm other people. And I don't think as a collective, we as tech and as VC do that in any reasonable or accountable way, to use Claudia's really excellent language.
Yeah, I just want to add that probably one thing you said that I think is really important to call out is like, it's creating a path for excellence. And I think that like that comes from leadership directly, right? Where it's like, you can't just say, okay, well, everybody works in the same way. So then, you know, whatever, we'll just, if you bring underrepresented people, if you create this path to like bring diversity in, it's like, it's not just like, that's it, your job is done. It's that you have to get to the next level where it's like, okay, great. Like, how do you show somebody what leadership and management skills are? How do you help them move to like moving forward and get in there? And you have to find a way to do it in a really active path where it's like, I'm like, you know, this is my first time being a founder now. I've worked at a lot of different companies and from like very early stages as well. And I've seen the difference between, I think, managers who try to frame a path for excellence versus those who are just like, just figure it out on your own. And it's really hard. It's hard enough when you don't come from a place necessarily where you've seen that over and over again. I'm quite fortunate. Like I'm very privileged. And like, when I look at my educational background and the companies that I've worked at, like I've had a lot of opportunities to be able to do that. Not everyone does. Certainly not a lot of people like have like can see like, oh, this is what it means to like manage up. This is what it means to say things in this way or do these things or play these like political games if that's what you want to do. And in a way, like, no, I'm saying that people should be encouraged to play political games, but that you have to recognize like what it means to try and succeed in an office and to be in a business and like find a way towards management and leadership in a positive way. It's hard.
Go, Claudia.
I was just going to say, I mean, I could not agree with you more, because there's so much of the allyship work that needs to be done, but also embedding that into what a successful manager actually is. I've seen it. I just came from one of the most horrible experiences in my career of working, I just worked for a bank for 6 months, who was, and they were just falling apart in the most stupid ways and just telling us that, you know, people and integrity are the number one thing. And then all they were doing is the exact opposite. And when I looked at it, and this is just my experience and my opinion, is that they had promoted a lot of people, and a lot of people were in charge of other people's careers and lives and performance and their working life, who had no interest, training, or any capability to actually do that. They just happened to be good at the job they were managing. And I think that becomes really, really destructive in terms of, this is the one path of success that we have carved, is that you get promoted into leading a team of people that used to do what you're good at. And that has, I think, from my point of view, really hacked at alternative success paths and actually making sure that people who don't fit that one model can get ahead in their careers in their own terms and not under the terms of somebody who has no business being in charge of them in the first place.
I think it comes down to, you know, who is in charge. I had a question that I shared with you folks before the panel. What would it mean to have a diverse group of decision makers across an organization? And in answering this question, I would love everyone to draw on their own personal experience with their careers so far, with what they've done so far and what they're doing right now, and just talk about how that could have been different or might be different with a more diverse group of decision makers to bounce ideas off, to ask for advice, to ask for permission, that kind of thing.
I think for me, one thing that you would expect, and I don't think this is a bad thing, is you'll see more conflict. And I don't, right, which is different than like fighting or violence. So I want to like separate that. But when you have people with like a different set of values and perspectives, like you actually do expect to see more conflict. So I can say that like the leadership team that I'm on right now, sort of leading the people and experience team with some other folks at CultureAmp, we have, there's like me, I'm like Latina and Indigenous and American. We have a white South African who's like an immigrant to multiple countries, a couple of like white Australian women, a Jewish man. And what's interesting is we actually work together really well. And that's because we're like empathic, that we all have like different sort of agendas and perspectives, but like we disagree like a reasonable amount with each other. And so it takes like emotional intelligence skills, but that's something I would say is that, especially for cultures where like just agreeing and like being agreeable is like seen as a cultural value, like diversity is not really gonna get you that. But I also don't think that that gets you innovation or excellence either. But I don't think we should act like when there are more perspectives in the room, like it's gonna be easier and rosier all the time. Like, I don't think that's true. But then again, I don't think that that is a desirable state to end up in.
I think it's like any relationship, like the idea that you have- like- Sorry, go.
Oh, no, go ahead, Joni.
It's like any relationship, is if there is absolutely no friction, it's not growing. You don't have a chance to find out more about who you are. Like, it's better to have a relationship where you find friction, talk about it and solve it, than just to keep on agreeing with everything and stagnating. And I think too many companies might fall into that because they just keep on hiring people who look like them. And the only friction they have is just like managed friction. There's no chance to grow.
I was participating in a large organization's workshop a little while ago, and because it was a whole of organization change that we were exploring, they invited in people from all parts of the organization, and you knew, even, you know, it was in a big boardroom table with a big U-shaped seating all the way around, and you knew even before anybody said a word, as people were sitting down, you could tell, you know, what corporate class each of these employees was by their dress, by their hair, by their mannerisms. And so then, of course, when this sort of consultative, what was meant to be a consultative process began, all the people who weren't leaders in the organization just completely clammed up. And then afterwards, speaking to the leadership about it, they were saying, you know, one of them said, why do we even invite people from elsewhere in the organization if they're not going to contribute? You know, so they're stuck in this negative feedback loop where the people, you know, that they need feedback from aren't comfortable because they've had that beaten out of them, not physically, but obviously, you know, in that culture, that feedback's not welcome.
That's what we need to be paid 20% more.
I was just going to say, we definitely face this at our company. We have a large office in Sri Lanka as well. And there's a different set of cultural norms. So like for me personally, this isn't necessarily like a D&I thing, but like one thing I've learned is that I really need to slow down my speech because I sometimes speak so quickly that they like don't understand what I'm saying. But there's also this, there's a concept, it's really quite prevalent in Sri Lanka. It's like power distance, right? Where your manager can do no wrong. Or even if they do, you're not allowed to tell them. You're not allowed to say anything. And it's a really hard thing to overcome where it's like, no, 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 it's okay. I know I do stuff wrong. Tell me, please tell me. And it's really, really difficult to get them to do that, you know? And so I think like in the, it's actually been a good learning experience for me. And like to, like my nature, I'm a bit more reserved. Like I don't ask for the feedback as much. And because I've kind of had to go so much further over the line to be like, no, no, tell me what you really think and do it in a lot of like one-on-one ways. Like, I think it's forced me to become better at just like, because not everyone is comfortable in large group settings, being able to just speak up and do things, right? We're not all like equally extroverted and just like, we'll say whatever needs to be said. You actually really have to sit down with people one-on-one, establish trust. Because if you haven't established trust with someone, no one's going to tell you what you're doing wrong in any sphere, whatever those things happen to be. And I think that that's really a key part of this, right? Is like friction's all well and good and you want to have the friction, but the friction, positive friction is never going to come without trust. And so I think the starting point is to be establishing that relationship with somebody that they feel like you can get that feedback, you can get that criticism.
I think that's really true. And there's a comment right here in the chat that kind of taps onto that, which I think we should just kind of chat amongst ourselves about. So somebody here says, conflict and disagreement suggests that everyone's ready to have the conversation. But what if you face indifference and apathy when it comes to talking about building equity through diversity? I think that's a really good question. What does happen if you just face apathy? If people just don't care, they're not fighting you on it, but they don't care at all.
I've experienced two levels of that, which I found really interesting. Again, I speak to a lot of people who coach leaders, senior leaders here in the US and in Latin America. And there's kind of two things that are in the crossroads of the apathy and the lack of action I feel in tech here. The first one, and I think this is shared in Silicon Valley, is that tech as an industry, startup as an industry, and innovation as an industry, we are all running around masquerading like we're super progressive, forward, left, radical liberals about everyone's welcome and all of that, when truly we aren't, right? We use the same contracts as everybody else that say wife instead of spouse, or that have arbitration limitations for legislation and all these crazy oppressive structural things that we are living in every day. And I think that mask gives a lot of people permission to say, oh, but we're the ones that are moving the country forward and having the new ideas. You know, of course we're progressive, and then all these microaggressions that end up being big aggressions kind of bubble up, and it becomes kind of like the stench in the room that it's invisible, but everybody can feel. And then the second one is that diversity, and this kind of goes back to a little bit what Alan was saying before, diversity as the sole thing that will drive things forward can also be part of that mask, because it can be better performative. I've been part of teams, leadership teams, where half of them are women, a lot of them white ladies, but women nonetheless, female identifying. And, you know, the founder and the boss can say, well, of course I'm inclusive. Look at all the ladies here. If you don't listen to them, if you're not actually taking into account their needs for the decisions that are being made or the policies that your company has, or how you interact with customers or how success is measured, what is the point, right? They might as well be cardboard cutouts. So to me, those two things, the performative nature that diversity leadership can have, coupled with the progressive performative nature of tech as an industry, kind of create a little bit of a perfect storm for inaction, because we can point to other things that are happening as if change was occurring, when it's happening way too slowly and it's costing way too much.
Wait, Claudia, you mean like just putting some brown people and women on your careers page won't solve structural exclusion?
Yeah, pretty much.
Having an ERG group so that the marginalized people can eat lunch together isn't the same thing as promoting and paying them?
Yep. No, like ordering curry for Diwali.
I say that snarkily, but also the other thing that like makes me a little bit, I have a whole bucket of emotions for it. It's like bereft and furious is when people say, oh yeah, we're spending lots of money on DEI. And then you find out that 90% of the budget is in recruiting and controlled by a white dude. That's not DEI budget. That's actually capitalistic colonization. And so like, I just want to name that when you say like you're investing in it, what that means is like investing in designing and auditing equitable internal processes and holding yourself accountable for outcomes. Like, sure, recruiting is a piece of the puzzle. Like at CultureAmp, like we're certainly like, recruiting is a piece of that, but like the first and primary project that we did was looked at our performance management and assessment systems and said, are these producing fair outcomes? Are the qualities that we're looking for like culturally coded in ways that certain types of people can't succeed? And so I just want to say that like people are like, oh, we don't have budget or we can't do this. Like, just don't design a shitty performance system that's designed for Mark Zuckerberg. Like that's a thing that you can do. And I promise you, because I did a complete overhaul with an amazing partner at Atlassian a couple of years ago, and we had exactly zero budget. So don't tell me that it can't be done or you don't have the money. Like, I think that's another thing is like spending $50,000 on like to get your name slapped on a banner at like an LGBTQ gala does not actually help marginalized people in the LGBT community, right? Like, if you have $50,000, go donate it to trans women of color so that they can be economically empowered. Just give it to them if like that's the cause that you wanna choose. So again, I just wanna like to underline this idea of like diversity performance, like doesn't help anyone except the people in power to feel better about not doing anything. And like, if that's what you're gonna do, I'm actually okay with it, but also admit that's what you're doing.
Yeah, truth say it out loud.
I can tell when I'm being used as a PR tool by individuals and by organizations who get clout just because they retweet me and, you know, they want to appear to be behind me. And so I guess, you know, I'd love to hear any experiences that anyone has here about times when you have been that token person or you have been tokenized and, you know, how you respond to that. Because, you know, it's a delicate balance. You know you're being used as a PR tool, but also you get to have visibility. It's this tough thing.
I'd say that's a lot of my career. It's like, can you be in the room so a brown person can be here? it's been a lot of that. I remember my first job ever at a startup environment. There was a big fancy group coming in to talk to the leadership of this company, and the founders noticed that there would be no women in the room, and they asked two of the marketing team to join. And we're like, wait a minute, is nobody going to ask why no ladies are in charge as opposed to just inviting to random people who happen to be at the office here today? I remember that a lot. And that was 12 years ago. So it has stayed with me because then I've seen that happen at different kind of macro and micro levels over the last 12 years. So yeah, it's been happening a lot.
Yeah, I distinctly remember the one of the times it happened to me. I was asked to speak on this conference of women in PE or something like that. I was just treated so disrespectfully. And I even wrote a blog post about it afterwards. And I feel like now if they tried to do something like me again, I just flat out call it. But I think at the time it was just, you know, it must have been like a decade ago. I was too young to realize it. And it's like, I was clearly there for like token representation. I put a lot of effort and time into like creating a talk that was high quality and bring it to front of people. They're like, oh, we're not going to pay you to come to the conference. We're not going to do anything. We're not going to do anything else. Turns out every single other person at this conference, every other speaker was paid transportation, given a speaker fee, given a special gift. And I was just treated like this, like not even a second class citizen to like come up and show up at this thing. And I know I gave a good talk. I know it was valuable. I know a lot of people like got a lot out of it. And it made me feel so bad. And like, the thing is that like, you know, I made me personally just feel like the thing that makes me really angry now is that I question myself. Like, I was like, am I lesser? I wasn't good enough. Like, is that what it was? When actually what I should have been doing is like, literally like, fuck that conference. fuck those organizers, because like I'd never deserve to be treated that way. And that's the funny thing too, right? It's like you don't even realize sometimes that you should be angry. Like, because I just didn't know. I was too young. I just didn't realize that that could happen, and that's how it was.
Wait, but were you exposure?
Sorry, folks. Just want to ask everyone to just close the chat screen because somebody is bombing us with rude messages. So if you are in the chat, just close it out and don't worry about whatever that is, because it's clearly somebody who is white. And we'll get back to our conversation.
I noticed that was happening, but one thing I will say about the chat and like what just happened, nobody look at it, it's dumb, but like that person probably works in tech.
Oh yeah, they absolutely would.
And so I think that's the other thing is, like, I will just say, having like been in tech for a long time, I think, like, I really do believe in general that people are fundamentally good. I don't know how I'm not cynical after doing this work for this amount of time, but I think there's actually something that tech needs to talk about openly, which is there are people who are actively and intentionally abusive, racist, ableist, sexist, whatever. And I think that we like to pretend that it's just about some people like not knowing how to do better. And I do think those people exist. But I think we also have to be honest that there are people who are intentionally abusive. And like that is an actual problem. We know that the tech industry especially, right, when you look at what we call the manosphere online and like the incel community like that is horrifying. Don't Google it. Right, one of the most disgusting and misogynistic sort of cultures on earth is disproportionately represented by people with like tech and gaming backgrounds. And so I just wanna like acknowledge that I think our industry, we talk about like these structures and all of that, but as you just saw kind of a demonstration of this kind of really disgusting behavior that's not just like antisocial, it's actually like fundamentally disordered. So I just like wanted to name that also for folks that have not experienced that kind of stuff before. That's just kind of bread and butter for underrepresented people in this industry, which is horrifying. Like, I'm not in any way normalizing it, but I just wanted to name that because I think too often we want to be like, it's just a few good people who don't know. There are a lot of good people who don't know and can do better, but there are also a lot of people who get off on plausible deniability of abuse.
People think that when I want inclusion in tech, I want more job offers. The truth is, I just want to be able to go on Twitter without being called a training faggot. You know, it's just, that's what I'm after.
Oh my God, wouldn't that be
nice? Yeah. Just to kind of lift this a little bit, I wanted to talk about, I'm thinking about Nazis now. I want to talk about some more positive stuff here. So how do we begin to cultivate a sense of belonging? Alan, I'd love to throw this one to you to begin with, because you've seen a bunch of organizations throughout your career. I'd love to hear about that.
It does, I think, begin at the very beginning. It's something as simple as the part of town where you first decide to get together with your co-founders or your team and start a business. And I remember the first time that was it was an issue for me was, I often use the hashtag suck at Surrey Hills because I spent about 20 years of my career working in various places in Surrey Hills and I don't anymore, but I still really love Surrey Hills. But one of the first startups that I worked with in Surrey Hills, we needed to work after sunset, and there were members of our team that didn't feel comfortable with walking to and from Central Station to where the office was, you know, maybe 800 meters. And you know, as a 6 foot something white man, that had never occurred to me as a cis white male that you know, would be an issue for other people. So that's a, you know, like just even like what part of town we put our office in is an issue, right? So how people access their office, is there a lift or do you need to be able to walk upstairs? And then how we furnish that space, and then how we meet and interact as a team, you know? So back in my day when I was a young product manager, you know, by default on a Friday night, sometimes on a Thursday night too, everybody would meet at the pub for a few beers, and that was really inaccessible to those people who felt comfortable in the pub in that noisy environment with the smell, who felt comfortable with drinking a few alcoholic drinks before opening up with colleagues, you know. So it really starts at the beginning. If you want to nurture a more diverse garden, you have to prepare a garden bed so that the people you're hoping to attract will see and feel that space and go, you know, I could make a home here.
Mina, throughout your career, you've come from massive tech organizations to founding your own tech company. I'd like to hear about, you know, any lessons that you've learned about fostering that sense of inclusion and how you're bringing them to play as a founder.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about this too. It's not conceptually the things that I've, companies that I've worked at. Now, I've worked my way down. The first company I started with was 50,000. Then I went down 25,000. Then I think it was like 200, 100, 20, and now one when I started. You know, it's funny, like the thing that's actually had the biggest impact in my really thinking about this was having a child. And I just didn't, my son's about 20 months old, so he's still very young. And throughout the process of like my pregnancy and like having a kid, I was just like, oh, like, not that I'm like, not that I drink a lot, but like, yes, very socially, I enjoy having a glass of wine on a very regular basis. And I was like, oh, this is what it's like to go to a place and be like, try to hang out with people knowing that you're not going to drink anything. And I think it was such a like eye-opening thing for me, because it wasn't like I was actively, you know, I'd be like, oh, let's plan a team event, let's do this thing, whatever. I wasn't like actively trying to exclude people, but like, I'm also just so like, I'm making the same mistakes as everyone else. And like, it wasn't until like getting pregnant, having a child, I was like, oh, wow, I actually really need to think about this. Like, what do we do if you don't want to have a training core, if you come from a family with a background of alcoholism or whatever it happens to be, right? And so like, I think that was one big thing. I think another thing is like, I've actually predominantly worked in like, okay, so like my whole career has been in like tech and finance, right? And like, I worked in finance in New York, and then I worked in tech in San Francisco. And so I've really kind of been at the heart of a lot of this stuff, of just like not really like just seeing it there continuously around me. And it's funny, because like, I think when you're in the place, in the company, doing the thing, you don't fully acknowledge it. You don't fully realize it. You sort of have to get away from it to feel that. Like, you know, I started at Uber when it was 20 people, right? And it was a completely different company when I first started there versus when I left, it was 4,000 or 5,000 people. And I took 4 months off after I left Uber. And I really needed that time to just sort of like figure a lot of things out for myself, like about like the experience and what it was. And don't get me wrong, there are a ton of great things about the experience. I'm actually very, very grateful to have had an opportunity to work at the company. It's done a lot of stuff for me, including, you know, a lot of financial independence that makes a big difference in my life. So I'm very appreciative of what I learned there, the ability to work on, you know, something that so many people use and that touches a lot of people in a lot of different ways. And I think if I try to narrow down, like, okay, in all these different experiences, what are some of the things that I've learned to cultivate belonging in the company? I think it's that, you need stuff to be documented. You need stuff to be written down, right? Like, if you have a point of view of how you think your colleagues should be treated, write it down. It doesn't have to be a 40-page employee handbook, but you should have a 1 or 2 pager. And it's funny, because like, I'm only just realizing that now, like my company is getting, you know, 60, 70 people. And I was like, oh, we don't have anything written down. Like, it's crazy, we need to do this. And so we're doing like a team sort of like session next week to really just kind of like put those things down on paper. And more than just values, like values are one thing, you can do that, but to live your values, I think you need to give people a written and concrete representation of what they are. And then I think the second thing is just in terms of the, like, especially in a COVID world, right? When you've got all of this, like, you can't just be next to somebody, you have to do a lot of stuff virtually, you have to be remote to do a lot of these things. It's like trying to find ways to connect with people in a way that isn't just the stereotypical, like, let's get drinks, right? And just thinking about the things that people can do and approaching it. Like, we've done all kinds of like really fun stuff. And I don't think I ever would have considered those things before had COVID not forced me to think about, like, hey, what are people's individual situations? Like, what if you can't get childcare at home and you're stuck with like a, you know, 2-year-old running around in the background? And like, my 2-year-old interrupts my Zoom calls every once in a while, and I just hold him up and he says hello and he kind of goes off and does his thing. But I think like just being a lot more open to the fact that like, you know, life and work collide, and that's okay. And like, there's a way to embrace kind of both of those things together. Sorry, that was a bit of a meandering answer, but.
No, not at all, totally, yeah. Folks, we are coming up on 12 o'clock, so I might start to switch over to some audience Q&A, just so that we can get a few of those voices in. There are a lot of great questions and comments in the chat, but I'm hoping some of them will pop over into the Q&A now as well. I want to start with this question from Code Like a Girl. Do you have any good resources for understanding Australia's baseline of diversity representation in the technology workforce?
I have a Trello board on my Twitter that everybody can access. There's a lot of your writing in there, Joni, and Aubrey and Alan and a bunch of stuff. So there's that to start. There's some organizational design in there as well, which is my bread and butter.
I would say for folks who are looking for a baseline, like knowledge, go there. And then if you're thinking about like what is the baseline of representation, I say don't look at the baseline of the tech industry. Look at a census data. So I think one, I will tell you as someone who has spent a lot of time looking for that data in Australia, like how many brown people are in tech, I have no idea in Australia. Like that's a number I can reasonably get in the US. But I would say that I don't actually see that as much of a problem. People seem really obsessed with benchmarking their sums like against their mediocre peers. And I just don't think that like benchmarking is that exciting or useful. My method is to go look at like, what's the population of the country or maybe the state that like my office or my community is in, where am I now? And then set like, say, you know, your goal is full representation, but like if full representation is 10% of something and you're at 2, your next goal is 3. Like who gives a shit what the rest of it is? Like, that's what I would say to folks is like, I understand the desire to benchmark, but I think where there isn't data, we often let that stop us. And the answer is like, look at what the world looks like, try to get as close to that as possible.
Alternatively, you can also look at, I mean, that's a wonderful way of looking at it, because then you can go and say, well, how do we open up the doors to our workforce to exactly these people? If you have a founder who wants to have commercial numbers, another way of doing it, an alternative way to doing it would be to look at your user base and who you want represent your customer. And normally that is a 50-50, just in terms of like gender identity, if you are a consumer brand or if you're a consumer tech brand. So there's a few entryways in there. If one doesn't work, you have another one.
All right, next question. How did you build up your confidence in language to call out tokenistic representation and work towards a more constructive conversation? Mina, I'd love to throw that one to you. If you have, you've had an impressive career across these organizations and you would have had to build up a pretty thick skin for this to just be able to respond and answer to that kind of tokenism.
Yeah, I mean, to some extent, I think you just kind of have to take the punches as they come to you a little bit. I think one thing that's hard, you know, when you are from a different background than is the standard for your industry is that you feel like you have to work twice as hard as anyone else. And like, whether or not that's fair, it's like, I think for me, like just feeling this need, like I have to prove myself. I have to be amazing at this. Like I can't just be a 9 out of 10, I have to be an 11 out of 10. And I think like, for me, that was really helpful. And at least in the sense that it's like, all right, well, I'm an 11 out of 10, so you have to listen to what I'm saying, right? And I think like, that's part of what it is. But it comes back to a little bit to what I said before. It's like, I didn't know I should be angry. Like, I think it was like, I just questioned, maybe I'm not good enough, right? And so to me, the first step I have to get over is like, no, I am good enough. And only then could I get to the point where I'm like, hold on, if I'm good enough and this is still happening, then clearly something's wrong over here. It's not me. And I think that's the biggest thing is, how do you get over, is it me? Like it's a question of just, I think, finding a way to whatever that is, and whether it's, you know, like therapy, I think is always an incredible, I think everybody should go into therapy personally. Like it's been really helpful for me. And I just think it's a really good thing. And it's kind of overcoming the stigma that it's me is a huge part of it.
But I cannot emphasize enough how much I agree with you about therapy. It's just everyone needs to be in therapy. My rule is I don't even date people who aren't in therapy. Which is, yeah.
Oh, I would, I'll offer a little bit more. I mean, I think, first of all, I've always been snarky and shot my mouth off a lot. So like, I think there's, that's just like part of my nature. But the thing I wanted to call out when someone said like, where did you get the courage or whatever? I spent a lot of my career like not saying the thing, thinking that it would like give me more access or like more resources or whatever. And like, it didn't do that. So I think for me, like, there's not really a big difference in like the risk of like saying it or not saying it. Cause like you get shut out and you get like blackballed regardless. And so like, if those things are gonna happen no matter what, I'd rather say something with conscience. And like I said, I also wanna call out that there's, you know, ways that I have a lot of privileges being white passing, the fact that my disabilities are invisible that like give me more space to do that, I think, in meaningful ways. But I think that's one thing is so many of us at different points in our lives, like play the, what we call respectability politics because we think it will make the systems like be nicer to us. And like, that just doesn't work. Might work in the short term, but it won't work in the medium or long term.
Yeah, I don't notice any difference in being really polite and respectful to people and telling them what I'm really thinking in terms of how they respond and whether they change. So, you know, I think if it makes you angry, I think you have to let that out and you have to share it with them. It's going to help you a little, even if it doesn't help change them. But I struggle with it too. I'm not a type A, a middle-aged white male. I'm a type B middle-aged white male. And it terrifies me to take on the alphas and speak up about things. I would much, much rather try and find an opportunity to speak to somebody, you know, discreetly one-on-one after the event. But the problem with that approach is that the person who's being tokenized or marginalized doesn't see that happen, and for everybody else in the room, they don't see that that behavior is discouraged by anybody there. They see it endorsed and everybody moves on. So it's a fight for all of us to learn to call it out as it happens directly and be confronting enough that everybody rocks back on their heels a little bit. But it's hard.
Yeah, but that's what makes you such a great ally, Alan. Like, you and I worked together for a little while and I've experienced that through you. You've also seen me angry at work, like hands on hips and like steam coming out of my ears. And I really do acknowledge what Aubrey said in terms of how much of that confidence and all of that, it also is a product of privilege. And I've been able to kind of reverse judo move that in a way. And I'm gonna share something that most of you on the panel might know, but not people who are probably listening. I did not know I was not white until I landed in Australia. I had an equivalent privilege back home. And when I came here, my big shock was, why aren't doors just flinging open for me? And everybody wants to listen to what I say and nobody cares when my birthday is. Like, I truly was perplexed. And that, I think, informs a lot of my of the work that I do now. But that does fuel me because I feel entitled in a way to be angry at things because I, again, did not know I was in the minority until I was confronted by it in the workplace. So my default setting is to be a squeaky wheel because that's how I was raised and that was the system that I was in. So in a way, I do understand how much it is different to be received as a brown angry lady as it is to be received like an angry white dude. But that has been something that I've on purpose try to lean on when I need to talk to people who need to listen. And that doesn't mean that I'm not wrong all the time, but I am very, very lucky and very fortunate that in that way, I haven't found that hurdle in myself. And I live with anxiety and imposter syndrome, and that's a different conversation, but that I've held on to that little shred of privilege that has nothing to do with me. It has to do with my paradigm moving from Latin America to Australia, for sure. Angry corgi energy.
Folks, we are coming up on the end of the panel, the end of the discussion today. There's one question in the chat that I want to comment on before we finish up, and it's this. Someone's asked, if someone is so narrow-minded and insecure about themselves, they are a homophobic racist, isn't the answer just hysterically laughing at them? They will remember that feeling more than any education or argument that you can put to them. And this is something that people bring up a lot and they suggest a lot. And I want to tell you why we don't do that, because it's really hard to laugh at somebody who is treating you as less than or as other, or who is threatening you or excluding you, because it's just not funny. There is nothing to laugh at there, because we feel unsafe and we feel persecuted, and we are unsafe and persecuted. The answer is never laughing at these people. There's nothing funny about them. The answer has to be responding to them.
I would also plus one everything Joni says always, but I also want to just respond to that to say that the reason that people are harmful is because they are hurt. I don't think that means that they're not responsible and need to be held accountable for the harm and the hurt that they cause, but causing more hurt and shame and harm at someone will likely only re-entrench them. And so I just want to call that out, that like, it might feel good for us to like be an asshole back to someone who's an asshole. But so my grandma's like from the South, and the next thing we say is like, you got to get down in the mud to wrestle with a pig. And so like, right? And then you're just covered in shit. So what I would say is like, if you have the ability to, like, your energy is better spent like supporting the person who's been harmed, or if you have the privilege or the space or the capacity, like greeting that person with love and with healing. Because you know what? You don't fuck somebody up who's being mean more than being mean back to them, being nice to them. That's what they're gonna remember. And so I would just offer that, that it can be really tempting to go to that level, but like, let's all embrace our inner Michelle Obama and her arms if you can get them, right? Like when they go low, we go high.
This is very true. I think that there's nothing more radical in 2020 than being kind to people.
It's chaos, be kind, make cookies.
Folks, I want to thank everyone for being a part of this panel today. It's meant a lot that you've all been here. I struggle sometimes doing Zoom panels because I need body language to be able to read people and coordinate discussions. So thank you for your patience in that. I'd like to really acknowledge and thank AWS for sponsoring this and for being a part of it and helping to make that happen, because that was awesome. And it's great to be able to gather here today. Thank you all for your time. And as I mentioned, you should all buy trans people chocolate.
Good chocolate too.
Thank you. Good chocolate. Yeah, I like mint chocolate, so send that my way. Thank you all for being a part of this. We really appreciate your time. It's a-